And welcome to worship at Guilford College United Methodist Church. Today, a verse came to mind as I was waking up and getting ready for worship this day. It was a verse I heard many times growing up. The pastor would stand up front, and as part of a call to worship, he would say, "I was glad when they said to me, 'Let us go to the house of the Lord.'" I'm so grateful that we can be here today together as God's family, right here on a corner in Greensboro. I hope that you are ready to feel the warmth and the greeting of our whole family that's here, as well as the touch of God who's inviting you into relationship and fellowship with Him. Today we have a lot to be grateful for, but before I go in to share some of those things with you, I wonder if you would take the attendance pad. It should be in the edge of your pew. And if you would go ahead and sign in there just to let us know that you're present. And as you're doing that, I want to thank the Lord for the birth of a new baby. The proud grandparents are Samantha and Joshua Ingram. The parents are Josh and Samantha. Don't make those grandparents yet. Grandparents are Paul and Pam Ingram. And great-grandma's right here present in the back, Carol Ingram. The baby's a beautiful girl, and they gave her the name Molly Elizabeth. For this, we are so grateful, a healthy baby. I also want to mention that this week we have two of our members that will be having their 96th birthday. Both Becky Archer and Helen Phillips will have their birthdays this week, and we're so happy for them. We're grateful that we know them and have been able to observe their lives of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The Camp Gilrock experience was a great time for all of the kids that got to go. I was lucky enough to see them go off and come back in the afternoons, and they just had a great time. They were hot, as you can imagine, but they had a great time. I want to thank God as well for this weekend when the serving day turned out to be a serving weekend for Tommy and the crew that's been working since Friday making tables that we'll get to place in new homes for families that come from a place where they've been displaced. I thank God for the whole team. They've been working so hard, and they'll work again today because it's serving day. Also for yesterday, Jim Sandknopf's team, who was out at a special lady's house making a wheelchair ramp. I'm so grateful for all the work that's been accomplished. Some of the volunteers are here. Now, after this service, you have an opportunity to still serve. Just meet us in the fellowship hall, and we'd love to make sure that you're in service for the Lord on this special day, July 14th, Serving Day. Now I'll pass it over to Pastor Jeremy, who has a word for us.
Good morning, church. Grace and peace to you here and all those of you in the sanctuary. As Pastor Susan said, there's so many things we're thankful for today. I'm also grateful for the Crump family musicians who led us in our prelude today. And it's a real blessing. Y'all, but before we get into the heart of worship, I just wanted to share some thoughts with you all that maybe have been in your own mind today. As we gather for worship this morning, many of us are reeling from the shocking events of yesterday when a would-be assassin attempted to shoot and kill our former president and current Republican presidential candidate, Donald Trump, at a rally in Pennsylvania. We are all horrified that such a thing happened in our nation. We are all, whatever our political persuasion, deeply thankful that the former president seems to be okay. We all grieve the death of at least one bystander and the critical injuries suffered by at least two other participants, as well as the trauma suffered by many others. We all, as followers of Jesus, condemn yesterday's attempted murder as what it is, an evil act. We also all share a deep concern that such evil actions not lead to just more evil and violence. And so I would like to call all of us to exercise great care in the responses that we make in this tender time, and particularly in the words we use. This is not a time to belittle the events of yesterday. This is not a time to fan the flames of animosity or to engage in either hasty assumptions or thoughtless stereotypes. This is not a time for tasteless attempts at humor or for trying to score cheap political points. It is a deadly serious time. I shared just last week that democracy ultimately depends upon the character of the people, of the choosers. And there is much that depends upon the character of the people, and especially God's people in this moment. Now is one of those moments when we choose between ways that lead towards life or ways that lead towards death. I hope that now will be a time when we choose to, as someone said, lower the temperature of political debate in our country and to turn away from listening to those who are doing the opposite, whatever their stripe or affiliation. I hope this might be a moment when we might choose to end the politics of mutual destruction and stop treating elections as fights to the death. I hope we can all choose to talk about one another as nothing less than fellow Americans who are deserving of each other's respect. No more belittling. No more hatred. No more. Now is a time to turn away from bitterness and fear and to turn to each other. Now is a time to focus on building a nation that is truly one, and in the words of the pledge, indivisible. That word, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Above all, now is a time to turn to God, the ultimate ruler and judge of all peoples. And so in that spirit now, let us worship the true God and let us enter together into a time of prayer. Would you bow your heads with me? God, hear our prayers today for former President Trump, for his family members and loved ones, for the bystander who was killed yesterday, for those who were injured, for those who suffered trauma, including those in health care and law enforcement. Hear our prayers for those who have hatred and murder in their souls, for all the victims of gun violence in our world today, for those who live in fear, for our leaders, for your church's response, and for our nation. God, give healing, give guidance, give courage. Save us from the violence that is within us and the violence that is around us. Help us to listen to the better angels of our nature. Enable us to hear your call of eternity above all the noise of now. Make us instruments of your kingdom's peace in our fractured world. And help us tell your better story to the nations and show them your more excellent way. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. Would you stand? Take the time to welcome your neighbor today as we begin our worship this morning. Join me as we sing. We have a story to tell to the nations. The words will be up on the wall.
Church, we want to pause in worship today to make a special recognition. Pastor Susan recognized Helen Phillips and Becky Archer's birthdays coming up this week, and there's another very special birthday happening around this time. As early as the fall of 1958, a group of people in our area began meeting together and discerning together about the possibility of forming a new Methodist fellowship in the growing community of Guilford College. By the spring of 1959, Dr. J. Clay Madison, who was then superintendent of the Greensboro District of the Western North Carolina Conference of the United Methodist Church, issued a challenge to the group to organize and to build a new congregation and offered to them the annual conference's support. That June of 1959, the annual conference assigned Reverend Fred Barber to work with the group to organize a new Methodist church in the Guilford College area. And soon Reverend Barber, Dr. Madison, and the Reverend Roy Eubanks of the nearby Old Friendship Methodist Church issued a call for the Methodist people to formally meet for worship for the first time in July 1959. They met in the Student Union Building over at Guilford College on the campus. At that first service, they had 57 people who were present and 38 folks who joined the new developing fellowship. The new church was formally organized in August of 1959, and 102 charter members were recorded by the Reverend Barber as of October 25th of that year. I share that with you because that is how Guilford College United Methodist Church began. That is how we began. As I mentioned, that first formal worship service was held in July 1959. It actually occurred on Sunday, July 12th, 1959. And what that means is that this past week, our church turned 65 years old. We basically qualified for Social Security. And that feels like something we should take a moment to celebrate. And so that's what we want to do for just a moment. And so, first of all, we'd like to take a brief moment to honor those first members whom God used to give our church its beginning. Many of those charter members, most of them, have gone before us into the church triumphant. A few are still with us. Some of those folks can't be here today, including Helen Phillips and also Sandy Proctor. There are also a few of the founders' family members who are still with us. We'd like to just take a moment to honor all of those folks today, both those who have gone ahead of us and those who are still here. Now, there may not be anyone who fits this description present, but I wonder, is there anyone here who is either one of the founding members of the church, or you are a family member or a descendant of a founding member? Is there anyone here? If so, would you please stand? Okay. Would you join me in celebrating both Susan and others for that special recognition? When our church was formally constituted by District Superintendent Madison, and you can go ahead and turn to the second photo. Thank you. This is a group of that people who met in 1959, 65 years ago. And when our church was formally constituted by the district superintendent, he proclaimed that it was organized to the glory of God, the proclamation of the gospel, and the service of humanity. And here we are today, 65 years later, still glorifying God, still proclaiming the gospel, and still, especially today, serving humanity. We are even doing what our ancestors bravely did, working with the conference to give birth to a new faith community, so that the cycle continues, this one called Brazos Abiertos. So today, on the 65th anniversary of our church's first worship service, we want to thank God for that legacy that has been passed down to us, and we want to pray for our church as it enters its next chapter. So I'd like to invite you all to join with me now in praying together the responsive prayer of gratitude and grace that will be found on the screen. And I want to invite you all to respond with the words that are in bold at the bottom of each slide. Let us be in prayer. Eternal and loving God, today we give thanks to you for your goodness through all the years of worship and witness in this place, for your grace in calling us to be your people, for your love revealed to us in Christ your Son, for your gift of the Spirit and the joy of salvation. For those who established this congregation, for their faith and vision, for their gifts and abilities, for all who have been members of this congregation, for those who have given freely of their time and money, for those whose wisdom has guided our congregation, for all those who have preached and taught here, for all who have confessed here that Jesus is Lord, for all who today lead in worship, witness, and service,
we give you thanks, O God.
Give us the assurance that we too belong to that great company, and grant us to experience with them the fullness of your joy and salvation. Amen. Amen. One last prayer. Would you join me in this? God, continue to lead, guide, and provide for your church in this place so that through us, new and diverse generations may come to know you and may discover abundant and eternal life together through your Son and in your Spirit. Amen. There's one last thing. Oh, sorry. I'm ready to move on. I'm excited. Let's join in this together. Help us to celebrate your grace, to share your good news with all people, and to love you, our neighbors, and ourselves in Jesus' name. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I think we're done praying now. There's one other thing we'd like to do in this recognition. Thanks to our church historian, Becky Archer, we actually have the bulletin from that first worship service way back in July 1959. And that Sunday, the congregation began the service by singing the hymn, "I Love Thy Kingdom, Lord." And so in honor of those who've come before us, in the hope of all those who come after us, we're going to sing that hymn together now as well. So I want to invite you, if you'd please stand as you're able, and together with the church on earth and the church in heaven, let us sing.
You may be seated. Good morning, church. Let us continue in this spirit of celebration as we turn to our offertory. Very quick, I just want to say that we are, again, ever grateful for your constant and faithful giving. God provides for the kingdom work we do together through you. And we want to thank you for just being there and constantly sharing of what God has blessed you with to bless others in our community. There are different ways to give. You can give via text, you can give online, and there's also an envelope right in front of you. So with that, I'll invite our ushers to come forward.
Thanks, Melanie and Andrew. That was lovely. We come now to our prayer time, and I do have a few people within our congregation and our community that we are remembering. Remembering Steve Tucker and his family on the passage of his father after a battle with cancer. We remember Sandy Proctor. She's recovering from surgery and has had a rough couple days this week. We pray for Nadine Stump, who is going to have surgery upcoming this week. We pray for Matt Stump after a serious accident at work. For one of our very, very longtime members, Mary Jane Gordon, we pray for a successful and calm move for her on Monday as she moves to a new location, that would go smoothly. And then we do have several in our church dealing with cancer, going through treatments, Lisa Hodges, Barbara Jones, Tom Jenkins, and Emily Chilton. And in today's prayer, we're going to lift these names up. We're going to leave just a few seconds of space for you to speak aloud or in your heart, those in your own life whom you're praying for. And then we're going to pray for our serving day that's going to start in just a minute. And I'll be using a prayer by St. Ignatius of Loyola. If you'd like to view that prayer and pray it along with me in your heart, it's on page 570 in your hymnal. Let's be in prayer together. Gracious God, we thank you for this chance, this time to gather together, and to gather together in a way that we often don't, where we are all together in one service. We praise you for the faces that we see this morning that we might not see every other Sunday just because of a change in routine. So God, thank you for shaking up things in our congregation just a little bit, for sending your Holy Spirit to be among us and to work within us. God, now we bring before you those within our hearts and within our congregation who are struggling with illness or difficult times. We lift the names of those in our own hearts, silently or aloud, before you now. God, you are the source of healing and strength. So today we pray for Steve and for Sandy, for Nadine, for Matt, for Mary Jane. We pray for perseverance for those in our congregation who are battling cancer, for comfort, for strength, for Lisa and Barbara, for Tom, and for Emily. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, we are so thankful today that we have this chance to worship differently, to worship you through serving you. You've told us in your word that when we help others, when we serve, when we do the work of compassion and justice, that we are really doing it to you. And so, God, we pray that you would bless each project happening today and all of those volunteers that are working in it, that they would be your instruments of peace and of love. We pray together from St. Ignatius that you would teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward, except that of knowing that we do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we're all gathered together, as Jesus gathered with his friends and disciples, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Church, last week we began a new sermon series on the saga of King David, but today, in honor of Serving Day and being kind of a different Sunday, we're going to pause that, and we're going to hear instead a message drawn from the book of the prophet Isaiah. So I invite you to open your heart and your mind to God's word, and I invite you to please stand as you're able as Barbara comes up to serve as our reader.
And welcome, bienvenidos. I'm Barbara Laura Tano, and I invite you to remain standing as we share in the reading of Isaiah, chapter 58, verses 1 through 12. Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose, a day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong, and you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Is not this the fast that I choose? Would you pray with me, please? God, we ask that you would give us the power of your Holy Spirit so that even in these words, we might hear your word, and that your Spirit would do its work within us, your church. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Once, long ago, the people of Israel were trying to get God's attention. Things had not been going well in their nation, politically, economically, and above all, spiritually. Things seemed really dark. The people were longing for revival, for a new spirit, for a new dawn to rise. So the prophets and priests and ministers called everyone among the people to turn back to God. And specifically, the religious leaders issued a call for the people to repent. They called upon everyone to humble themselves before God. They instructed everybody to fast from eating food for a time and to direct the hunger they felt towards the Lord. The religious leaders sounded the shofar or trumpet and summoned the people back to a life of worship. So that's what many of the people did. They fasted. They showed up at church and synagogue again. They sang the Psalms with new fervor. They offered burnt sacrifices of their crops and livestock. They cried out to God. Some even went so far as to take ashes and put it in their hair as an expression of sorrow for their sins, as if every day was Ash Wednesday and as if that was some kind of new conditioner that had been developed. Others started a new fashion trend by wearing robes that were made out of stiff, scratchy goat's hair. The coarse fabric chafed their skin and represented their discomfort with the state of their people and their own soul. So the religious leaders issued this call to repent, and the people responded. And then nothing happened. Nothing changed. And so the people said, "What gives, God? We're fasting down here and it's like you don't even see us. We're humbling ourselves just like the preachers told us to do, but you're not even giving us the time of day." Before he became a Christian, the writer C.S. Lewis said he experienced God as like a person who never answers your letters or your emails. So you come to the conclusion that either he doesn't exist or that you must have his address wrong. That's how the people were beginning to feel about God. They cried out from their designer sackcloth and their ashy foreheads and they said, "God, we've read 2 Chronicles where you told Solomon, 'If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and will pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land.' Well, we're trying to do at least some of that, so where are you? What gives?" And this time, through the prophet Isaiah, God answers their letter. Only it's not the kind of answer the people were hoping for. Because God responds with a searing indictment of the people's worship. This is the Troxler translation paraphrase, but basically what God says is that all you think I want from you? That you just humble yourselves and fast? That you just roll around on the ground over and over saying how sorry you are for your sins? Do you think it's enough for you just to lift your hands and sing praise songs over and over and over? Or that you make a lot of sacrifices or give big offerings in my name? Do you call that worship? Will you call that a day acceptable to the Lord? God questions the people after the people had questioned him, and God makes clear who'll be asking the questions here. And then God says through Isaiah, "Truly I tell you, that kind of fasting and worshiping will never draw you any closer to me. And it will never allow you to have the kind of spiritual power that you seek in me." Because God says, what I care about is not just how you approach me, but how you treat other human beings in my name who carry my image. God goes on to explain to the people what God means. The truth is that even though you are fasting before me, you are still being a jerk to your neighbors. You leave worship, and then you go out to eat and are mean to the waitress and leave a meager tip. You sing of justice in the sanctuary, but then you go and oppress your workers by not giving them any time off, by not paying them enough to live on, and not treating them with dignity and respect. You pray for peace at the altar, but then you go out and quarrel and fight and even resort to abusing each other, even committing acts of violence. God says, you fast, but then you swing with your fist. You put on sackcloth, but you won't clothe your neighbor who has nothing but rags to wear. Do you really think that is the kind of worship I'm after? God says. Do you really expect me to bless that? Whenever I eat, I always try to offer a blessing over my meals. And sometimes I will pray that God will bless this food and nourish my body. But the truth is that for God to accomplish that with some of my meals on my plate would require a kind of miracle of transformation. Because sometimes my prayer is basically, God, please bless these 3 pounds of pork barbecue and this mountain of fries and these dozen hush puppies and this gallon of sweet tea and this heaping pile of mac and cheese and these 2 pieces of apple pie for dessert, Lord, and help them to nourish my body and keep me healthy in your service. Amen. And God's like, really? You really want me to respond to that prayer? That's basically the same answer God gives to the people's ethically empty fasting and praying. Really? You expect me to bless that? The problem with my meal blessing is that I am often asking God to bless what isn't necessarily aligned with God's best intentions for me. And that's the problem with the Israelites' worship. Their actions aren't necessarily aligned with God's ultimate desire for them and what God wants for their neighbors too. So after calling out the people, God, through Isaiah, spells out the kind of worship, the kind of life God does want, the kind of life God's blessing and power can be found upon. And again, like Jeopardy, God answers in the form of a question. God says, is not this the kind of fast that I choose? To unlock the shackles of unfairness and injustice that bind so many of my children? To remove the heavy burdens that weigh people down to the ground? To free people who are being exploited or abused or just forgotten about by the powerful people and systems of this world? Is not this the kind of fast that I choose? God says. Is it not to give food to the hungry? To bring the homeless poor into your house? Boy, that's a challenging one. When you see the naked, to cover them. And not to hide yourself from your kin who are in trouble. That, God says, is true worship. Not just falling on your knees, but loving your neighbor in need. That is a true fast. Not refraining from food, but refusing to do anything that hurts God's children. One of the key biblical doctrines that Christians believe is that every single person is created in the image of God. That every single person bears God's likeness, no matter what they have done with that likeness. And what that means is that whenever we encounter another human being, we are standing in God's presence. C.S. Lewis again wrote that next to Holy Communion, our neighbor is the holiest object presented to our senses. Every human being we meet is holy ground, so much so that when we meet each other, we should perhaps genuflect and cross ourselves. Every other is an altar. And so what Isaiah presents is a kind of altar call. Not a call that we come and be with God by kneeling at the railing, but a call that we go to be with God where God's children are hurting. And Isaiah says, that is what repentance looks like. That is what true worship leads to. That is the kind of fast God chooses. And if you do that, God tells the people, then spiritual power will begin to flow in you and through you. In fact, God offers a kind of if-then statement through Isaiah. God says, if you remove the heavy yoke of injustices that are pressing people to the ground, if you stop pointing the finger and speaking evil of each other, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, if you do that, God says, then your prayers will get off the ground. Then you will experience me in new and deeper ways. Then you will call and the Lord will answer. Then you will cry for help and God will say, here I am. I think many of us sometimes struggle with the mystery of unanswered prayer, especially when we read those scriptures that make promises that if we just ask God for what we need, then we will receive them. But I believe some of that mystery boils down to what we mean when we say that we are praying in the name of Jesus. Praying in the name of Jesus isn't just adding a pious phrase to the end of a petition. To pray in the name of Jesus means that we are praying from a life aligned with God's heart. A life that is directed along the grain of Jesus' work in the world. What it really means is letting Jesus pray in us and through us. What that means is that prayer in the name of Jesus is never selfish. We don't pray in the name of Jesus to get a boat or a truck, however much we might want one. Neither do we pray that our team wins the baseball or soccer game, but God, please help both England and the Braves today. Instead, when we are praying in the name of Jesus, we are asking for the kind of things that Jesus desires. We are praying for the hungry to be fed and the naked to be clothed, that the fighting would cease, that oppressed people would find freedom. And I do believe God always answers those prayers. If nothing else, God answers those prayers through us. Here's the thing. Isaiah 58 suggests that God wants to fulfill our petitions together with us. God looks to God's people in the world as God's partners in setting people free and in lightening their burdens and in showing them the mercy and compassion they need. God wants to accomplish these things not through magic, not even primarily through miracle, but through us. I heard a sermon this week by a United Methodist bishop named Jonathan Holston, who's from South Carolina. And Bishop Holston told us a story about what happened the day his teenage daughter first got her driver's license and was given the keys to her first car. Bishop Holston said there was a driving rainstorm that day, but despite the pouring rainstorm, his daughter drove off into it just as free as can be, as if she didn't have a single care in the world. Mostly, he said, because she wasn't the one who had paid for that car. Well, sure enough, some ways down the road, Bishop Holston's daughter runs into a curb and she gets a flat tire. And so she calls her dad and she says, Daddy, I've got a flat tire. I need you to come and fix it. And so Bishop Holston says, oh, okay, I know, I'll come. So he gets in his car and he drives through the rain to where his daughter is. Rain's just pouring down in sheets. And he gets out of the door in the rain and he knocks on her driver's side window. His daughter is doing her makeup in the mirror, but then she rolls down the window and says, oh, hey, Daddy, the tools are in the back of the trunk if you need them. I'll wait right here. And then she went back to her makeup. And Bishop Holston just stood there for a minute soaking wet. And then Bishop Holston, soaking wet, said, I know that too, yes, but daughter, we're going to do things different. This time, we're going to do this together. And she gives him a blank stare and says, but Daddy, it's raining cats and dogs out there. Yes, daughter, I know. But we're going to do this anyway. So open the door, get out of the car. It may be uncomfortable, but we're going to change this tire together. God's people call up God and say, God, the world is broke. Life is flat. We need you to come fix it. God shows up in the sanctuary. The tools are outside, God. We'll wait. And we go back to what we're doing. God says, no, 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 no. We're going to do this together. So step outside. Step outside with me. We're going to change the world together. Y'all, today is our Sunday serving day. Immediately after worship, we're going to engage in service projects about living beyond ourselves and loving our neighbors and loving the world, all as an expression of our love for God. And we do this at least once a year on a Sunday to remind us that ultimately, this is the kind of fast God chooses. This is the kind of worship God wants. Us stepping outside the church and revering our neighbors and joining with God to make the world better together. And I can't think of any better way for our church to celebrate its anniversary or birthday than through a Sunday serving day in which we carry on what a small group of people began before us, glorifying God, proclaiming the gospel, and serving humanity. And I can't think that there's a better time for God's church to do this, because what a divided nation needs is a united church, a group of people who have turned their backs on hatred and violence, who have chosen the way that leads to life, and who have come together under the banner of the Prince of Peace and the Lord of Love. And God gives us this promise in Isaiah that as we do so, the darkness will turn to dawning and the dawning to noonday bright. And Christ's great kingdom will come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. Let's practice the fast God chooses. Let's step out and change the world for the better together. Glory to God. Amen.
Well, would you stand now and join me as we sing Sent Forth by God's Blessing.
Just a moment, we're going to join in a final prayer, and you're invited to go together to the fellowship hall, either through the right, through the doors, or down the hallway to the right. If you've already signed up for a project to do, that's great. If you don't, there's still some opportunities that we can help direct you to. And one last thing. Next Sunday, we're very excited about something. Sunday evening at 5:30, we're going to have a hot dog and hamburger picnic on the back field. And we're going to have Cane Mill Road, a bluegrass gospel band who's going to be here. We're really excited about this. So bring a chair, make plans to come. If it rains, we're going to move inside. We'll have it anyway, but we hope you can join us. But now as we go forth to serve, if you join me in the prayer that we're going to put on the screen, and let's let this be our benediction together. Lord, here we stand with the whole city gathered at our door, waiting for our Sunday celebrations to end, hoping that we will notice that there is a community outside these walls, longing for healing, help, and hope. As we walk through these doors, help us to worship and work with our eyes open, so that we might love and feel and even ache with our neighbors. When tomorrow comes, let worship continue to flow through our hands, testifying to your love and greatness. Amen. We go in peace.
Thank you.